You bless us. You bless us. Thank you very much. A minister without words. I normally don't bring Graham up, but you know, I just want you to know that he is my partner in this, my strength, my love, and so I just want to remind you that he's here too. Thank you for that amazing warm welcome back. So welcome everyone to Unity Church of the Hills. I'm Reverend Cherie Taylor-Jones. I'm the minister here, and it's just an honor and a privilege that I get to hold the knowing of your truth, hold you in love, see you transforming to your highest good. It's a privilege. It's a privilege to do this work with you. So I also just wanted to take a time to thank everyone that sent me cards of support, emails, online posts, hearts. I mean, I just can't tell you the amount of outpouring of love and support that Graham and I have received. It's been super meaningful to us both. And so I just wanted to start there by thanking you and also just acknowledging that we are in a big shift. We are in change. We are in transition. You only have to walk outside the door, and you know change is a-happening. So that's on the macro level, right? We know that the world that we used to inhabit no longer exists in that way. We all have been forced to change, so it makes sense that from the macro to the micro, that it would happen here as well, right? Change. Change sometimes can be very uncomfortable, though. You know, we like what we like when we like it, and we don't have to think about it. It feels good. But part of the passion of this organization is transformation. It's in your vision statement. It's in your mission statement. And transformation doesn't happen by just sitting in the silence. That might open you up to finally hear the divine, to finally hear your soul's purpose. Transformation happens by doing the work. By doing the work. And doing the work doesn't mean putting positive affirmations on top of stuff that is brewing underneath. Okay? That's the Band-Aid, my friend. And so what that calls for now is for us looking at our beliefs. I talk about that an awful lot from the platform. What are our beliefs? Because our beliefs drive us. And so what you're hearing in the field are some old unconscious beliefs. We all have them. I have them. It took me a while to figure out that I had an unconscious belief that people with wealth were not of God. Did you hear that? And I figured that out in my first ministry. And then I was like, well, that doesn't make sense prosperity-wise now, does it? Right? We all have unconscious biases. And here, in this particular community, you are used to the spiritual leader looking a certain way and being a certain gender. You're used to it. That's the norm. No shame, no blame, no nothing of that. It's just the way it is. And so now you have someone that looks completely different than your norm. Thank you. And it's hard to look at the unconscious beliefs that we have about what someone who looks like me would act like, would sound like, what her power should be like, right? We make sense of the world by categorizing people, by putting people in boxes so that it's easier for us to understand. And I'm saying transformation means taking them out of the box. That's what transformation means. So as we do this work, my friends, there's going to be some uncomfortability. There's going to be some joy. There's going to be laughter. There's going to be some tears. All is God. All is growth. All is transformation. Now, I've been talking with Frank, our board president, and I'll be expanding that to talking to the board about things that we can put in place to start doing the work. There's healing that needs to happen here. And I know you're saying, oh God, not the healing conversation again. Lord, haven't we done this work already? A one and done is not the work. So attending one session to talk about it is not the work. The work takes some time. So I'm going to be looking at what kind of workshops do we bring in? How do we facilitate the conversation? When do we have the town hall meeting? When do we do the focus groups? When do we do all of that? And you may be thinking, oh, that's Unity Church of the Hills problem, not mine. Well, you're here because you resonate here. And if you resonate here, then there's something here for you to do as well. So it may not be specifically Unity Church of the Hills, but it may be some unconscious beliefs that you have in how you outpicture in the world. And that will heal here as well, because it's not about this situation. It never is. It never is. So this is going to require all of us. All of us. Whether you're new, whether you're old, whether you left before and now are starting to come back and you're like, oh, I don't want to deal with all of this. It's life. It's life. So I welcome you. I know that you are ready to do this because you are here now. All right, so let's talk about finding yourself in transition. What a concept. There are no coincidences. Finding Yourself in Transition is a groundbreaking book by Robert Brummett that talks about how do you handle change. Interesting that we should have this workshop now, right? So that's going to be on February 20th and 27th. It's going to be via Zoom, and it will be from 2 till 5. So gives you time to leave church, go get something to eat, relax, and then get on. It's going to be hosted by Linda Hancock, Rick Busby, and Sandra Vella. They have done an amazing work on getting materials together for you to utilize, for you to dig deep to do the work. I have to tell you, every time that I'm going through a change, I pick this up as a reference, and I kind of refresh. Oh, yeah, this is normal. Oh, really, that thought is normal. So if you're able to, I know some of you may have done it before, take the opportunity, please, to do it again. Spirit circles are also forming to support this book study as well. So here's my passion. My passion is that as we offer things, that we make it available in lots of different ways so that people can do the work. So we had that first one, which is offered on the workshop, the 20th and the 27th, and then we're inviting the spirit circles to also facilitate this book study. The wonderful thing about the spirit circles are they're intimate settings. So it's just, you know, 8-10 people, and you're just communing and connecting. It gives you a deeper dive while allowing you to also feel connected in friendship and in love, and that it's safe to do that work. So if you're feeling called to participate in a spirit circle, we have, I think, about 9 circles available now. You can either go online or there's a sign-up sheet out in the foyer. Do you feel that energy? Oh my, oh my. Woo! Celebration band, you know I love you, right? Good, I'm glad you know. Oh, it is so good to have a little time for renewal. So thank you for your blessing and your patience with that very much. So we're talking about what are you becoming? Are you continuing to expand to your highest self, to manifest your soul's worth? Well, if not, maybe you need to stop chasing the external goals and align yourself with your soul's purpose. You know, you use your soul's intentions to create your best life. Sounds good, doesn't it? You're probably like, yeah, but how do I know my soul's intentions? Well, we're going to break it down in a concept that many of you understand. If you've worked in or for or with a corporation, then you're going to get this idea, because I'm going to talk about vision statements and mission statements. Did you just go, oh God? Because I heard that. You might have had the thought of like, oh no, did I pick the wrong Sunday to come to church? Maybe there are a few of you that are just like, let's hold on, something's good gonna happen here. Thank you, those few people, I appreciate you. Thank you. So, what if you had a new understanding that these statements can be applied to your life in a powerful way that shifts your spirituality? Would you be open to maybe hearing some of that? Okay. You notice I have that verse up there. I've been using it a lot as we've been talking about rebuilding and growth. And it's from Revelations chapter 21, verse 5, and it says, behold, I make all things new. And what we are doing is we are making things new when we look at our old beliefs, our old understanding, kind of rattle it around, shake it up, does it make sense still? And then reframing and recreating. So we're going to do some of that work today. Now, here's the simplicity of a vision statement. It's the destination of an organization. Easy peasy. And the mission is the roadmap. How do we get there to that destination? Here at Unity Church of the Hills, we have a vision statement. So when you look at and you hear and you say that vision statement, this is what? The destination. We are an ever-expanding community of love and acceptance where lives are transformed. And we also have a mission statement. This is what? The roadmap. How do we get to that destination? How do we, as individuals, behave to support getting down that road? And ours is we put God first, celebrate life, serve truth, and empower people to transform their lives. You see, our mission is our intentions. Did you get that? Our mission is our intention. So when you read those statements, I'm hoping that you feel the power of the intentions. So the vision and mission statement, it represents a state of consciousness of an organization. State of consciousness of an organization. Vision statements are breathable and changeable. They shift over time. Can you imagine if Bill Gates, his vision in 1980 was a computer on every desk in every home? Can you imagine if he never changed that? Well, when that happened, what? He would have fizzled out and be gone, right? All right. So the thing is that the vision changes after we either reach a destination or we decide, I don't want to see the Grand Canyon, I'm going to go out to the West Coast, right? That's going to change. Or if we have transformed beyond it. And at this stage of our evolution here at Unity Church of the Hills, our vision and mission statements are still relevant and valid as we are on the journey to embody these truths. But what about you? What's your vision? Do you have one? Do you have one that's not tied to an external goal? Do you have one that's from your soul? What is your soul's desire for you to become? Because that internal knowing is your vision. That's your vision. Okay? So, do I have one? You know I do. So, here's my vision. To support the uplifting of consciousness in others to the realization of oneness. So that's my destination. And how do I get there? Through my mission, right? My intention to be the Christ and honor spiritual wisdom beyond this realm. Kyle Cease, in his book, The Illusion of Money, writes, "Your intention is your superpower. In any situation that is challenging, when you connect to your intention instead of the situation, you'll experience an entirely new level of strength." So this means that when a situation arises, I'm able to focus on the reason that I have said yes to being on planet Earth. I know my purpose because I've worked on getting clear in what my vision statement needs to be, right? I'll remind you again, it's about supporting the uplifting of consciousness in others to the realization of oneness. So, this supports me in cutting through the minutiae, because you know we've got lots of minutiae in our lives that we think is so important. So it allows me to cut through the distractions. And when something big happens that rocks my world, then I go to my intentions, which are to be the Christ and to access, listen, be supported by the wisdom beyond this realm. And as many of you know, I had an experience that really shook my world. And from the perspective of my humanness, I can tell you, I felt anguish, sadness, confusion. I felt really wobbled. And the universe supported me in so many ways. It was right before my spiritual renewal time. So you know what that meant? It meant I got to unplug, step back, look at it from an objective place, and then make sense out of it. Gift. And then Graham and I got to go down to South Padre Island. Graham actually took that shot. We were on the beach. And we had 4 days before the weather turned, but it was gorgeous. There's something about the water that just soothes me. And there's a sense of awe and the bigness of the universe. You know, so I got to kind of step into that. And then I received emails, posts, Facebook likes, phone calls, and I gotta tell you, they uplifted me. They filled my heart. They renewed my hope. I was guided to find a Hindu temple and a Tao temple, which allowed me to practice the realization of oneness. I was even called to attend a Buddhist workshop discussing the middle way, discussing how to move forward. And in the silence, I spoke with God, which supported how I serve and who I am. And those miracles happened because I was clear in my intentions to be the Christ and access light beyond my own knowing. So today, in my persona, a few of you have been like, "Are you okay?" I'm like, "Yeah, I'm okay." "No, you're not okay." I'm really okay. But there's a sense of vulnerability. There's a sense of vulnerability. And that's acceptable. And my journey is to be exactly who I am in authenticity at every moment. That's my journey. So all of this, The uncertainty, the love, the dislike, the anger, the confusion, the joy, the anticipation, all of it's God. There is no us or them. There is no right or wrong. There are simply beliefs that no longer support us. And it's a time where our highest self is calling for us to look at them and be transformed. And all of this that's going on is in complete alignment with my vision. Supporting others, lifting others up to the realization there is only oneness. So Cease says this, your intentions hold a loving and secure space for you as you go through challenging moments. Your intention brings you a perspective that can see beyond the momentary pain of letting go of an old story and helps guide you in the highest alignment. Whew, can you feel the power in that? Finally letting go of the old story, finally letting go of those things people told you you were, which aren't your truth. And this release, you know, it can often feel scary, especially when we are so strongly aligned to our mind. You know, as humans, we've come to believe that the mind thinks, and whatever the mind thinks is who we are. But that's not true. That's false. The mind is simply a tool that we use on planet Earth to function. But we have allowed our minds to overfunction. It is through your soul's intention, through your soul's internal vision, that you reclaim your highest self. So you're here now, Unity Church of the Hills, because you are aligned to this knowing. You said yes. You said yes to being here. You said yes, you're ready for the evolution of consciousness. Your vibration resonates with my vibration, so that we can do this work together. That's why we're all here. You may think it's a coincidence that we're sharing this time together, but I assure you we are each here by divine appointment. So guess what? This means that you're ready. What? You're ready. You are ready. And here's the other piece. You're equipped. Hear that. You are equipped to do this work. And as we do the work on releasing the mind as our driving force, let us do this in love. You know, our culture, the Western culture, says that if something bothers us, what we should do is try to cut it out and get rid of it. But that doesn't work with spirituality. With spirituality, what's required is an integration for wholeness. And how that looks is that love has to be the guiding frequency in the work that we do. Did you hear me? Okay, thank you, James. I'm glad you're here. What that means in this case is that we thank the mind. We thank our mind for keeping us safe and highly functional in the world. And we also let the mind know, hey, we're ready. Our soul is now ready and equipped to take over. Do you hear the difference in that? We're not at war or resistance. We're loving and bringing into our totality, to our wholeness. Cease calls this the internal revolution, which leads to true freedom. So here's what I know. The intellect divides and separates. Love heals us and calls us to oneness. So when we believe the externals as definitions of ourselves, we are not in alignment with the universe. We are not in alignment with God. And when we believe what other people say about us as true, we've denied our purpose. When we believe our job, the bank account, the hairstyle, the clothing, the dress size, the title we held in the past, the title we hold now, defines us, we have shrunk ourselves to the limitations of this world. Everything that we do is us either being pulled toward the expansion of our soul or addictively shrinking into the mental story of who we've been tricked into believing that we are. I know I was tricked for a really long time. So let's look at this expansion and shrinking in another way. How many of you remember Let's Make a Deal? Yes. Back in the day, it was Monty Hall who was the host, and right now it is Wayne Brady that is the host. And you know, the audience would be all dressed up in these outlandish costumes, and they'd be plucked from the audience to come on up and play to win some prizes. And sometimes Monty and Wayne would walk down into the aisle and ask people for like crazy things on their possession. So like, who here has a roller skating key on them? Yeah, not seeing any hands there. Who could be the first person to show me that they have a bottle of hand sanitizer on them? I gotta see it, bring it. Bring it, I gotta see it. Who's gonna show me the first? All right, $100. Did you pass that? For a bottle of small hand sanitizer. Not bad coming to church on Sunday now, is it? You saw that $100 bill came out of my wallet. That's one of my prosperity techniques. I keep a $100 bill in there, and so when I open my wallet and I look, any of those false beliefs that say I don't have enough, I'm not rich enough, whatever, pff, gone. Because I can look in here and I go, I got $100 I can spend any way I want to. Right? So I've been using that for years. And I have to tell you that it has helped rewire my brain and my nervous system that from my childhood made me believe that I would never have enough money to feel secure. Do you see? These are spiritual, practical tools that we use to transform, my friends. All right, back to the show. So what was the goal of Make a Deal? Let's Make a Deal? Prizes. Prizes. You could win a trip to exotic places, get new spanking cars, lovely furniture. And there were some times when you could be zonked. Remember the zonked? And you wouldn't win a prize. It would be something goofy back there. So why am I talking about the game? Because we are constantly making choices. We're constantly making deals and choices with ourselves. And Cease, in his book, took this game show idea and labeled two doors, a door of expansion and a door of shrinking. Door number one was expansion. Door number two, shrinkage or contraction. Do we pick door number one? Which is taking the action for our soul's growth and raising our vibrations? Or do we choose door number two, which gives us short-term pleasure based on fear? Here's the thing, when we choose a door, we really don't know what's behind the door, but we will know the path of the door that we've chosen. Anytime that we are making choices from our ego based on fear, we will be choosing to be zonked. We will be choosing to shrink, to contract. When we select door number two, we are choosing to blame. We are choosing to shame. We are choosing to hurt ourselves and others. All because we refuse to hear our soul's call. And how do you know that you're answering your soul's call? Because it will be made of light, of love of the Christ presence. Picking door number one is answering our soul's calling, and when we make that choice, it gives us the knowing of expansion and abundance. Our body is going to feel lighter and joyous. Here's another way. Another way of affirming expansion and never-ending supply that comes from within us is by giving. Simply giving. Giving raises our vibration. Seath writes this: giving is a way that you constantly renew yourself and stay connected more to your inner abundance than your mental attachment to external things. Giving is a reminder that there is no lack, no need to hoard. It reminds us that we have a wellspring of unlimited abundance within us. Giving activates spiritual truths that we can never outgive God. And all that we give will come back to us in wonderful and impossible ways. When we see our ability to give as based on the amount that we currently have, we are capping ourselves at the level of our current story and living within our limitations. If you're saying that you can't give past your story, you're also saying that you can't receive past your story. So you're stuck. So I shared my technique with having the $100 bill in my wallet to remind me of abundance. And my giving it away transcends my story that there is only a limited amount of good that's available to me, that only a small amount can I receive. Giving away shifts that. It changes my false programming and supports rewiring my brain. You see, I'm stepping into alignment with the universe, knowing that I am now in the frequency of possibilities. Before I stepped on the platform, I got a gift of a $100 bill and a card. Did you hear that? I didn't know it was coming. But simply my desire to give, the universe goes, you didn't lose anything. And it was wondrous. And the connection was amazing. I gained more than I gave. I'm all fired up, excuse me. And here's the other piece of giving. When I give, I release my expectations of what that person does with the money. What? Yeah, see, what you do with the money is your business. It's your journey. It's your decision to pick door number one or door number two. Not mine. Mine is to answer the intuition of my calling to give. Simple. And we give selflessly, not expecting something in return for the giving, but just aligning in the flow of abundance and possibilities. Giving allows God to work through us. All right, you know I'm winding down. On page 137 in the book, The Illusion of Money, there's an exercise about giving beyond your limitations, and it encourages you to kind of move yourself forward and view the world through the eyes of oneness. So I'm hoping that you will look at giving, look and listen and sit and hear your soul's calling. Tune in to the frequency of love, of divine, of allness, of abundance. Then you'll get to hear your soul. So, I gotta tell you, I know you are here for transformation, and the only way I know to support you in transformation is by challenging your belief systems, giving you permission to question, is this true? Is this who I really am? And giving you then tips to step into the newness. I believe in you, and I know that you are ready. You are ready to be your highest expression of God. Celebration.